guys?
I have.
I'm a teenage guy, so yeah.
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 Of course.
Yeah. I've seen it, yeah.
Yeah.
I have.
I was about 13, 14.
I was like 14.
Sixth grade.
11. Probably like 10.
About when I hit puberty, so around 11.
Probably age 12.
Seventh grade.
Fifth grade.
12, almost 13.
Like maybe like eighth grade.
I don't know, like elementary school.
14.
Probably when I was 13.
I accessed it online through the phone. There were just ads popping up at first.
I was like on a website and it just popped up.
Yeah, it was on my computer. I think it like popped up.
It just came across it, I guess.
On my phone.
Like 4 months ago, I was dared to watch it. On my friend's phone.
On my computer.
Yeah.
Oh, friends showed me, yeah.
Friends.
Some kid on the bus was just watching it, like showing everybody, being kind of like funny about it.
Probably a friend showed me, I think.
The first time I saw it, it was my birthday and my friend showed it to me.
I went to my friend's house and he showed me on his phone.
It was on a computer. Yeah, one of my friends was like, dude, you gotta see this.
Yesterday.
Like 2 days ago.
2 days ago, yeah.
Probably last night.
A couple weeks ago.
Yesterday, maybe?
Well, I watch it Wednesdays and Thursdays.
No.
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 I don't know.
No.
Mm-mm.
Nah.
No.
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 Uh-uh.
Yes. Once.
Kind of.
No.
Talking like once.
Kind of.
Nope.
No.
They've talked to me about it, but...
How many times would you say?
Like, twice, I think?
No.
Nothing more than, like, what it is.
Make sure that you're the first and best source for your kids' questions about healthy sexuality and intimacy. Find information and educational resources, like 30 Days of Sex Talks, at educateempowerkids.org.
So, this is our reality. Pornography is absolutely ubiquitous. It's almost impossible for kids to avoid seeing it these days. And I'll tell you that as the mother of an 11-year-old boy now, I sometimes feel a bit panicked about the whole thing. I think the fact that I'm sort of immersed in issues of exploitation and, you know, actually looking into the darkness of pornography regularly kind of intensifies that panic. Because I think, you know what, even with my eyes wide open and with everything I know, will I be able to protect him from it? I want him to grow up with a really healthy understanding of sexuality, his own, that is rooted in deep respect for himself and in deep respect for women. So I first talked with my son about pornography when he was 9. I had heard, because there was a bit of a battle between the moms, that a couple of the slightly older kids on our street had been busted looking at pornography on an iPod. And so when he said to me a month or so later, he said, you know, I think so-and-so is starting puberty, I thought, oh boy, okay. I need to get ahead of this before this kid or somebody else shows him something. So I started the conversation. And it was awkward, to say the least. But I explained to him why it was really important that if that friend or if anyone else tried to show him either pictures of naked people or videos online, or if he came across something on his own, that he make the choice not to look. I explained to him how our bodies and our sexuality are made by design and we're sacred, and how what happens in pornography is a terrible distortion of all of those things. I told him that what pornography teaches is harmful and it's really dishonest. So 6 months or so later, I was invited to present at a panel on Parliament Hill about pornography. And it was kind of a panel discussion and we were talking about it particularly as it relates to prostitution and sex trafficking. And after that event, I thought, okay, 6 months is a really long time in a 9-year-old brain. It's probably time for a refresher conversation. So I fumbled my way through it again, maybe slightly better equipped the second time around. And then one night, I don't even know if it was a month later, we were sitting around and he'd kind of been acting really weird all evening. He was sort of moaning and squirming in his seat and I thought he was sick. I didn't know what was going on. And finally he just said, Mom, I can't take it anymore. I have to tell you something. And he told me that one of his best friends at school, who was 9 years old at the time, had come across one of these free porn sites online had been watching it and had been encouraging the other boys at school to do the same. So my son didn't, because he remembered our conversations, and instead it took him a few days, but he did tell me he was afraid I wasn't going to let him play with this kid anymore. So we had another conversation, and this one was very, very emotional for me, because I know this site from my research. I know what's there. I know what this little boy was looking at. So I told my son how, first and foremost, it was important that he knew that he could come to me with any question he had, no matter what. I will do my best to answer. I even offered that his friends could come and talk to me. And my brave boy actually made that offer to his friend, who has not taken him up on it yet. But it's there, the offer stands. And he does, he comes to me with questions, and I, you know, fumble my way through it and answer as honestly and accurately as I can. Back in the spring, I heard from a neighbor's 12-year-old daughter that all the grade 7 boys have this very same site on their phones, because of course they have an app. This is our reality, and that is what frightens me. This idea that boys will be boys and boys want porn, increasingly graphic and hardcore porn, has so completely infiltrated our collective thinking. And of course, I believe in some ways it's true that boys will be boys. Big boys and little boys say and do things all the time that make very little sense to me. So I get that, but I refuse to accept that being a boy means being complicit in either an industry or in societal attitudes that exploit and demean women, sex, and those who engage in it. Let's say anyone is entitled to treat anyone else's sexuality and personhood as something that can be consumed, bought, or sold. I refuse to believe that men are born predisposed to be violent and misogynistic. My son isn't. Just because they're men, that's a lie. And I will do my best to raise my son to become a man who respects and values women and sex, and will never think it's okay to treat either as a commodity, whether that's on the schoolyard, in a strip club, on a street corner, or online. So boys who are being raised on internet porn are being robbed of, I would say, of genuine masculinity. I'm not even sure we know what that means as a society anymore. But they're being robbed of the ability to connect and relate and be intimate in real life with real girls, and eventually with women who are not on a computer screen or a mobile phone screen. They're growing up with distorted and unrealistic expectations of themselves and of their sexual partners. And as a society, we're just starting to see the implications of this, with more and younger men and increasing numbers of women addicted to pornography, more boys and men acting out sexually and experiencing sexual dysfunction in their late teens and early adulthood. Our pornified culture, as I referenced this morning, is grooming kids to believe that sex is something to be bought, sold, bartered, or traded. That it's normal and desirable to commodify your own or the sexuality of someone else. It's grooming boys at a cultural level to be users and takers. And girls are being taught that their bodies are the single most important thing about them, that they should seek male attention and approval at all costs. So they learn to emulate the highly sexualized dress and behavior that they see everywhere in pop culture, but then we blame and shame them for it. The culture is socializing a generation of young women to behave like porn stars, and I use that term loosely because it's quite a misnomer. Because except for the very few that the industry kind of trots out there as kind of window dressing on a very dark and abusive industry, there really aren't very many porn stars. Girls have to be socialized this way. We have to, because boys are being socialized to want porn sex. Sex that's anonymous and hardcore and often cruel. So the girls they're gonna hook up with someday have to be socialized to also think that this behavior is normal and acceptable. And everywhere we look, we see idealized, photoshopped, sort of homogenous examples of what, how we are supposed to look as women and girls. And that pressure never lets up. I mean, I certainly still feel it as a 41-year-old woman who has a pretty solid sense of who I am. So what happens to a 12 or 13-year-old girl who's growing up in this culture? Everything that girls see in movies, on TV, in magazines, and in pornography, tells them that girls and women are essentially split into two groups, those who are sexually desirable and those who are invisible. Gail Dines, she actually specializes in media study. She talks at length about this and about how the choices on how to be female or feminine successfully have really been reduced to basically one, and that's to be sexually desirable. Even highly successful, accomplished, athletic, talented women are evaluated largely on the basis of the desirability. Doesn't matter if you're a race car driver, a boxer, a musician, a golfer, any of these things. Pop culture sends the message that what ultimately matters is how sexy you are. And for girls to adapt to this reality, they have to learn to treat their bodies as things that please others. According to the American Psychological Association, self-objectification is a key process whereby girls learn to think of and treat their bodies as objects of others' desires. A girl must internalize what we call the male gaze. So the constant question she's asking is not just, oh, how do I look? It's, how do I look to him? A quick trip, we talked a little bit about social media this morning. A quick trip to any social media site will tell you that girls are fully buying into this idea that their value lies primarily in their sexual attractiveness. In fact, they bought into it to the point that they self-objectify. I mean, look at Facebook or Instagram. There's an unending stream of sexy selfies posted online for everyone to see, but not just to see, but to like or to rate. And they're buying into it because they don't see an alternative out there. The only alternative they see is invisibility, and that is not an option for a young teenage girl. Because being visible is so completely central to their identity. So, what is the effect of the culture telling her that what matters most is that she's desirable, and precisely what desirable looks like and behaves like, especially when all of that really comes from pornography and a pornified culture? Pornographer Joanna Angel said in an interview that girls these days arrive at the set porn ready. This is part of that perpetrating culture we mentioned this morning. Mass media has done this grooming already, and girls are forced into what Dr. Dines calls an early and artificial sexuality that is not of her own making. We have a problem. And if we as parents, professionals, future lawmakers and decision makers and concerned citizens don't figure out how to address this, we risk a society where boys continue to learn from porn at ever younger ages that women are to be objectified, humiliated, dominated, degraded, and worse, that no never really means no. We risk crippling generations of boys relationally and sexually and placing generations of girls in danger of sexual violence and exploitation. So one of the things that I think we can all do, and I'm really hoping that everyone in this room will do after this day, if not already, is wherever we are, to help change and challenge the public discourse around pornography. Anyone who opposes or even questions the sex positivity or the good of pornography is automatically labeled as prudish, anti-sex, or worse, as Glendine and I know well. Even those who are not coming from a place of faith. But we can't let that intimidate us, because the reality is this is not about being either of those things. Frankly, prudishness is a luxury we can't afford anymore when it comes to contemporary pornography, how it's impacting our children and our society. We have moved well past the point that we can talk about pornography as simply a matter of personal choice or preference, because kids are being exposed to it, to violent and degrading material, when they quite literally lack the ability to make the choice or to process what they're seeing. The idea that it's anti-sex to oppose pornography or prostitution is a lie of the sex industry. The industry tells us that both are good, both are sex positive. But those of us fighting back argue that you can't actually be pro-sex and pro-porn. Because to be pro-sex means to be pro-love, pro-intimacy, pro-connection, pro-creativity, and pornography is none of those things. To oppose pornography is actually to be pro-sex, pro-healthy, creative sexuality. We need to stop letting the industry define what happens in pornography as sex, because it's not. What happens in pornography is a formulaic script. It's played out by men and women to profit a massive industry. It is, as Baudrillard said, sexuality haunted by its own disappearance. But we live in a culture that's defined by this kind of rugged individualism, a belief in absolute personal autonomy and personal rights. And we see this play out in all kinds of ways in our society. There's this really naive notion that everybody's kind of functioning as an individual making free choices in a society, and we're more or less free of constraints in those decisions. But that's really rarely the case in reality. But this idea is very, very dominant in the discourse about prostitution and pornography. My body, my choice, my rights. So I'll do it with it what I will, right? But what's missing from this ideology is any kind of consideration of how things like poverty, racism, marginalization, abuse, all of these things play into these choices. Pornography and prostitution are not about choice, because choice is only meaningful when it actually is a choice. And for this to be so, you have to have a range of healthy, viable, life-giving options to choose from. And if it were truly a choice, then when a woman left pornography, she would have the choice to take with her every image, every video ever made of her, which of course does not happen. Now, do some women choose to go into porn? Yes, some do, because they believe this glossy, glamorous image that's projected by the industry. But it's not what they expect. The industry will tell us that porn is fully consensual. It's just sex between consenting adults on camera for pay. End of story. But true consent has to be fully informed, and girls entering pornography are not. Do they really know what it is they're signing up for? Do they really know what it's going to be like on set? Do they really understand the risk of sexually transmitted infections, because of course condoms are rarely, if ever, used on a porn set? Do they understand the very real physical risks to their bodies from the rough and violent acts they will be subjected to over and over? Do they really understand that you can never get those images back, especially in the internet age? So this discussion kind of gets all muddied and derailed by a battle that's going on between radical feminism and liberal feminism, which is both pro-porn and pro-prostitution. Just as an aside, you might be interested to know that Playboy, as it's reinventing itself, is hiring a feminist to write articles for the magazine. But this is a liberal feminist who's going to say what they want. So in this discussion, the media are largely, by and large, promoting the voices of liberal feminists, who I would argue have sold feminism out to the collective, or they've sold out the collective rights of all women for this really individualistic worldview. There is a remarkable woman Glendine and I have had the privilege of working alongside over the last several years. Her name is Trisha, and she's a survivor of many years of prostitution in Vancouver's downtown East Side. And I remember listening to an interview she was doing on the radio at one point, and she said something that put this whole conflict into perspective for me. She said that true feminism was always supposed to be about bettering and raising the level of life for all women. What would improve the rights and condition of all women? It was about liberating all women. Feminism was never supposed to be about me or my empowerment or my individual rights. It wasn't supposed to be about the individual rights of individual women, especially not when achieving my rights meant that the good of all women would suffer. Which is, of course, what happens big picture when we legitimize things like pornography and prostitution. The reality is that the vast majority of women who end up in pornography or in prostitution do so because our society allows sexism and misogyny, because they are poor, they're vulnerable, they're racialized, or they're exploited. And as I heard someone say, I can't recall who at the moment, the measure of the success of any social movement should be how the poorest of your group are doing. So liberal feminism is not doing a very good job. The industry also tells us that pornography is sex work. And we would argue, as we do, when the term sex work is used to describe prostitution, that it is not work like any other work. The term work just kind of renders invisible the violence and the exploitation that happens in pornography and prostitution. Geldine says that work under capitalism has meaning. You work up to 8 hours a day, you get paid your wages, and you go home to relative freedom. This is just not how it goes for most women in the sex industry. But the industry has so successfully shaped the conversation that society nearly blindly accepts these things as a matter of personal choice, autonomy, freedom, work, just like any other job. It tells us that porn is actually empowering to women, that it's a way of expressing their sexuality. And what's more, that to challenge any of it is to be anti-sex and to hinder sexual freedom. We have got to challenge this discourse because it's a lie, and it's a lie that's doing unprecedented damage. So how do we even begin to tackle this? The organization Culture Reframed has been promoting the idea that what we need is a Gulliver strategy. This is maybe an obscure reference to a book from the 1700s that tells the tales of a man named Lemuel Gulliver. And maybe less obscure if you've seen the 2010 Hollywood version of Gulliver's Travels with Jack Black. But the reference is to part of the story where Gulliver is taken down and tied down by a bunch of very little people called Lilliputians, who are upset with him for some reason or other, I don't remember. This image is where the idea of a Gulliver strategy comes from. For us, a Gulliver strategy means that we need to tie down this monster, piece by piece, rope by rope, from every angle we possibly can. Because there's no single simple solution, except maybe shutting down the whole internet, which really doesn't seem like a feasible option and would have all kinds of other repercussions. So, one of the things that we are sure of, if nothing else, is that probably the most winnable strategy, especially from a law and public policy perspective, trying to get the government, any government, to even consider tackling the issue of pornography, is to clearly frame pornography as a public health crisis. Mainstream pornography found on internet sites is not yesterday's Playboy. It's a multi-billion dollar industry of cruel body-punishing acts of making hate to women. This is the world your average boy is catapulted into when he types porn into Google. One third of the internet is pornography. Never before have youth had access to such hardcore porn. A global industry that has now become the main form of sex education around the world. It's time to create a public health strategy and regulate this industry to protect the integrity of our youth. So a public health issue is defined as something that affects individuals or societies beyond their capacity to correct or change themselves. Some examples of public health issues that governments have addressed include things like immunization, motor vehicle safety, and smoking. And once we see something as a social issue, the responsibility shifts from the affected individual to actually holding external social causes and influences accountable. Pornography is something that affects all dynamics of health: emotional, physical, psychological, relational, and spiritual. And again, I know I quote Geldine a lot, but she really is the leading voice out there on this. She said that individual families can't protect their kids from pornography. That's like telling parents to keep their kids from breathing polluted air. It is that ubiquitous. And no mass disorder has ever been resolved by treating only the affected individuals. We need a human solution. So what if we treated pornography like we eventually treated tobacco? Dr. Cordelia Anderson said that when people began to recognize the health consequences of smoking, our initial approach was to educate the individual and encourage him or her to stop. Over time, despite the industry's denial, it became evident that smoking was addictive. And the harm was done to the individual and to the public, all for the industry's profit. Now that research has documented pornography's harm to individuals and the public, especially children, it's time for a societal response to that issue as well. So for us, this will mean clearly making the case and communicating to our government the ways that pornography is harming the health of individuals, of children, and of our society, and calling for a strategy to address it. And this is going to have to be a strategy that is broad-based, that is multidisciplinary. We have to sort of come together across all kinds of sectors to figure out how to address these harms. So we will be looking at hosting informational events for MPs. Ideally, we would like them to hear from experts who can come and make a very clear case for the public health dimension of pornography. And we will call on the new Minister of Health, whoever that might be, to initiate a study in Parliament of pornography as a public health issue. There's a standing committee on health in the House of Commons. This is something that they could be handed and, you know, told to research, hear from witnesses, do some snooping and figure out what this looks like and how it's affecting people. The organization Culture Reframed is developing resources specifically to help build the capacity of parents and also of health professionals for dealing with pornography. You've heard it said, and lots of you have said it, that we need to educate parents. We need to educate teachers and health professionals so that they are equipped to deal with all of these new challenges that internet pornography are raising. Back in 2013, as I said, I participated in this panel on Parliament Hill about pornography, particularly relating to sex trafficking. And it was for MPs, but it was open to the public as well. And it was really interesting to me that almost everybody who kind of spoke up at the end, asked a question, made a comment, they were teachers, they were public health nurses, they were guidance counselors, they were rape crisis counselors. And they had all come because they are all seeing in the work they do how pornography is affecting children, families, women, and they are just desperate for this broad conversation to start. So there is a desire out there, it's just, we gotta bring it all together somehow. The second, some of you have talked about, is the idea of internet filtering. We are going to call on our government to require internet service providers to block pornographic content at the server level by default. This is based on what David Cameron did in the UK. What is being done, what he's trying to do. A 2007 study in the journal Pediatrics found that of youth exposed to pornography, 66% reported unwanted exposure. And they did find that filtering reduces the risk of exposure. Now, in Canada right now, if you don't want pornographic content in your home, we have to opt out of it. So we have to install filters or blocking software. And as you've heard, they're not perfect. Kids can find their way around it if they're savvy at all. But what about if your kid is at Tim Hortons or Subway or Starbucks? What about that on a mobile device? So in 2013, David Cameron announced plans that would cause internet pornography to be banned by default in the UK. So the legislation he planned would have required internet service providers to block content that was pornographic at the server level, but if you were an adult and you wanted to access it, you could opt in by contacting your service provider. So the intent of this, obviously, was to prevent kids from exposure to adult content online, which, you know, I think sounds great. The legislation, of course, was met with some pretty fierce opposition. So what they currently have in place is a voluntary system. But actually, most major service providers in the UK are willingly participating in this. Iceland was seeking an even stricter ban. They wanted to ban all pornography from the internet. They define pornography as being material with violent or degrading content. Print pornography has actually been illegal in Iceland for a number of years. So lots of voices are arguing, and rightfully so, that filters will never catch everything. Mm-hmm. You know, there's always a way around. Someone will always come up with a get around for it. And they also, to be fair, will catch sometimes more than it should, right? There's a lot of legitimacy to those arguments. And there's no question that it would be quite a process of finding a filter that would be sophisticated enough to do what we want it to do. But we have to err on the side of protecting kids. And, you know, we do understand, as you said, that filters will never, I mean, no technology is going to be the only answer. They cannot and should not spare us as parents, as citizens, as professionals, from having to actually engage with and educate our peers, our kids, anyone in our sphere of influence. But I do believe they will be a critical tool in our toolbox. So we need to start that conversation between government, parents, service providers, search engines, all the stakeholders, about how we can increase the tools we have to protect kids from adult content online. MP Joy Smith, who you will probably be quite familiar with, she had begun some work on this issue in the last parliament, and she said, "We currently restrict and protect children from exposure to adult content everywhere but on the internet. We delude ourselves if we believe that continuing unfiltered access to the adult content available online poses no threat to our children. In this massive fight against child exploitation and the sexualization of our children, every step we take makes a difference." So the internet is a public space, it's intended for information sharing, and it is federally regulated, though internet regulation is rather a black hole. But to start, we will be asking the government to introduce legislation to ensure some kind of opt-in system for pornographic material. We should also require internet porn providers to prove that they're actually doing all they can to keep minors from entering, seeing, or accessing their sites. These main free sites, like you type it in and it's there. There is no gateway, there's not even a, I mean, usually the age thing is a bit easy to get around anyway. But there's nothing. It's all right there. You can't buy cigarettes or alcohol without proof of age, so you shouldn't be able to access pornography. This is actually David Cameron's next focus in the UK, and he has said that if sites don't comply, he'll have them shut down. Now, I would love to see anyone in our government have that kind of courage to take a stand like that. We're also looking at whether we can better enforce our child pornography laws. There has been, as I said this morning, an explosion in child pornography online. And this is something that most people still feel very uneasy about. So child protection gives us a bit of a window of opportunity to tackle some of the online pornography. Again, Gulliver's strategy, rope by rope, piece by piece. As I mentioned, under our child pornography laws, it is illegal to even depict someone as being a minor in pornography. Well, you don't have to go two clicks in to any one of these free sites to find girls who are dressed and done up to look like they're 12 years old if they aren't actually 12 years old. They're advertised in videos like Barely Legal, Schoolgirl, Teen, Stepdaughter, etc. And under our laws, these are illegal, but they're right there for anybody to see. And we understand and have great sympathy for the fact that our police forces, who are tasked with the awful job of tracking down child pornographers and child predators online, they are beyond capacity trying to just keep up with the stuff that actually involves very young children. But there's got to be some way that we can, maybe it has to be a regulatory thing. We've got to figure out how we can apply these laws better. We're also asking whether we can apply our consent laws to some of the worst that's out there. Under Canadian consent laws, you can't actually consent to being physically harmed. This came up when the John Gomeshi case broke. So to say that women who are being brutalized in gonzo or torture porn have signed a contract consenting is completely irrelevant here. So we're going to look at whether this is another angle, another rope that we might be able to use. Similarly, we're going to look at whether our obscenity laws could be applied to go after some of what I call the low-hanging fruit, the truly violent and vile content. Our obscenity laws come down in part to a consideration of what violates community standards, and this has been problematic in all kinds of court cases because the judges just say, well, who decides what community standards are and who's offended by them? But surely, when we're talking about something like torture porn or you know, some of the really brutal stuff, I cannot for the life of me imagine how we cannot apply those laws to go after some of that content. And finally, we need to do a better job at educating our kids about sex and sexuality and about pornography. We have to figure out how to give them the information they're looking for, answers to things that they are really naturally curious about, in ways that are honest, accurate, and will hopefully make them less likely to go either to the internet or to their friend who's probably getting their education from the internet. So I talked a bit about this already. We need to equip parents to do this, and our schools need to be doing this too. I agree with you. I think we do need to have robust health and sex education in our schools. I, of course, think that parents should always have the right and the option to take their kids out of sections that they think are objectionable. You know, if you're concerned about what's going to be taught, absolutely. But in general, we're talking on a societal level. We've got to do a better job of giving kids appropriate information that's accurate, both at school and at home. I'm not sure if you guys have been hearing out here about all the controversy surrounding Ontario's new health and sex ed curriculum. I've been doing a fair bit of speaking on the subject, and I actually think there's a lot of good in it. In fact, what I tend to say is that I am way more concerned about what is not in the curriculum. For example, there's no mention of the legal age of consent, which is just weird. But there's also no discussion about the public health risks of pornography. The word doesn't even appear in the glossary all the way up to grade 12.
Really?
Yeah. Which is weird also because there's this whole focus, really good focus on, you know, internet safety, how do you stay safe online, addressing cyberbullying, all this other stuff, but there is no mention of pornography anywhere in the curriculum. And in line with that, I think we also need to teach kids media literacy. So how do we help kids think critically about the messages they're receiving in mass media? We talked this morning about how our brains are wired to absorb visual information as truth. I see it, therefore it must be true. This is what I'm supposed to look like, this is what I'm supposed to act like, this is what sex looks like, all of these things. We need to teach kids how to sort of think critically and deconstruct what they're seeing so they don't just take it all at face value. We should be teaching kids, and you don't have to do this from any kind of a religious or faith-based or moral perspective. Why can't we be teaching kids about the power of love and intimacy and imagination and all of these things? There is a fantastic organization in the US that's really starting a movement among high school students, and I think it's pretty exciting. It's called Fight the New Drug. I'm not sure if you've heard of it. And its materials and videos and speakers are all geared to teenagers. It's cool, it's edgy, it's informative. And their message is aspirational. It's not, you know, don't do this. It's aspirational. And it's working. So their main slogan, as you can see on the t-shirts, is porn kills love. And so they're calling young people to reject pornography in the industry and to aspire to real love, real intimacy with a real live human being, not pixels on a screen. I encourage you to check it out because they've got all kinds of great resources, you know, particularly if you're trying to think, how do I explain this to a teenager? They've got videos, they've got research papers, all kinds of great stuff. But this is, I follow them on Facebook, and they've got pictures all the time of like high school students from all over the place out, you know, with their t-shirts on, just representing the movement. And I think it's really exciting. So, good news. At this point in the day, you're going to get a well-earned break from the sound of my voice for a little bit. When I was thinking through this day, kind of how it should unfold, what kinds of things I wanted to cover, I really felt it was important that you hear a little bit from a woman I call my partner in crime. Glendine Girard is a dear friend and colleague of mine in this battle. So we have partnered together over the last several years. We have traveled extensively, we've researched, we've cried, we've agonized, we've brainstormed, all of these things. She's the National Director of Defend Dignity, an organization that exists to end all sexual exploitation in Canada. And for, I gotta tell you, for a tiny organization, they pack a really big punch. And that is largely due to the efforts of this amazing woman. Defend Dignity has been very influential across Canada. They have been mobilizing the church to engage and influencing decision and policymakers. So I wanted Glendine to come today, partly just because I enjoy doing this kind of stuff with her so much, but also to kind of, we've been sort of heavy down in the facts and the details, and Glendine can come and sort of share some of the church mobilization stuff and some of the direct action things that we're going to be involved in over the next few years. So sort of a hopeful, here's some stuff we can do. So I will turn it over to Glendine for now.
Pornography, strip clubs, escort services, massage parlors, prostitution. Do you feel uncomfortable hearing these words coming from me? What if I told you that girls my age are being exploited in these industries?
Of the women and girls being exploited, over 50% are Indigenous. And since 1980, there have been over 1,200 missing and murdered Indigenous women and girls. Selling sexual services is wrong. It attacks the dignity of women, men, and children. It is harmful to us all.
Defend Dignity believes each woman, man, and child, each person, is an image bearer of God and has value and worth.
Defend Dignity works to end all forms of sexual exploitation through awareness events held across Canada.
They advocate for law and policy reform and provide aid to individuals, churches, and agencies.
Defend Dignity acts as a change agent for individuals and churches to help end sexual exploitation in Canada.
It is possible to end sexual exploitation in Canada.
It is possible.
It is possible.
It is possible.
All right, thanks for letting me crash this Julia party. She does such a fantastic job, right? So it's just a privilege to be here along with her. And just in case you don't know, because we don't really say that on the video, we are the National Justice Initiative of the Christian Missionary Alliance family of churches. And there's 435 churches across the country, and we've existed now for about 4 years. And as the video suggested, and as Julia said, we are here to put an end to sexual exploitation in our country. We build everything we do on these verses from Psalm 82, 3 and 4, defend the weak and the fatherless, uphold the cause of the poor and the oppressed, rescue the weak and the needy, deliver them from the hand of the wicked. And we so believe that that is Christ's call to us as the church, that we need to be all about that. So I want to start today, this is going to be a real diversion, hopefully a little bit lighter from some of the heavy stuff that we've been into, but I want to share a little bit about how I, as a middle-aged woman, got into this whole issue. And one of the books that really inspired me was Half the Sky, written by Nicholas Kristof, and he says this: when our values are at stake, leadership must come from within. And that was very inspirational for me as an older middle-aged woman, and so I can't think of how much more inspirational it can be for each of you, many of you students who have your whole life in front of you, that can be set to work to end some of these hard and extreme challenging justice issues that we face as the church. So just a real quick story of how we got started, how we connect with EFC and with Julia on this work in pornography. My call to justice issues got started about 18 years ago now, just through my own quiet times with God's Word. No big visions, no nothing grandiose. I'm sure, as with you, sometimes God's Word seems like it's written just for you, that it's highlighted with a highlighter pen, and that's what was happening to me as I was devouring scripture that had to do anything to do with justice and God's heart for the poor and the marginalized. And I soon realized that that wasn't my heart. My heart didn't reflect his heart when it came to the poor and the marginalized, and so I wanted to change that. And I began to pray that very simple verse from Micah 6, verse 8, what does the Lord require of you? To act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. And I started praying that every day out of the simple, really practical sense that if God's word said that, then who in the world did he have me lined up to show justice and mercy to? Now at this point, we were pastoring not far from here. My husband and I were both pastoring at the Alliance Church in Morden, Manitoba. And you know, Morton is this beautiful, affluent little farming community, and I didn't feel like I was stumbling over people that needed to have justice and mercy shown to them. I'm sure they were there, but at the time I didn't see that. So eventually, after all the reading I was doing and God's word was in my head, I knew that I needed to put something into action, but what would that be? Well, by this point in time, we had moved to the city of Regina, Saskatchewan, and within 2 weeks, I had read an article in the Regina Leader Post that the food bank was looking for volunteers. And in my little simple mind, I thought that there would be poor, marginalized, and oppressed people at the food bank, and I was absolutely right. So my role there was to register new clients. And even though it wasn't a requirement, I often heard the stories of why they were there, what had taken them, what life's crisis had brought them to the food bank. And it was there that I met a prostitute for the first time. Now, while all this was kind of going on, I was also in leadership with women's ministries in our denomination, and we were being encouraged at by the president at the time to plug into a Canadian justice issue. We were very involved globally, but we wanted to look at something that lined up, something that faced women in Canada. And so what I did to begin that process was just to have some conversations with churches that I felt were really doing some good things in addressing some of the issues that face women and children. And it was through a contact with our downtown Vancouver church that I met this wonderful woman that Julie's already referenced, Trisha Bapti. Trish is a former prostituted woman who worked the downtown east side along with a number of Robert Picton's victims. And she has a delightful, winsome personality and an amazing story of tragedy turned to triumph. Well, you don't hang around with Trish for too long before you are compelled to consider this issue of sexual exploitation. And she agreed to come spend the day with myself and some others that were in leadership on one condition. She said, Glendine, I'll only come if you promise me that you will read through all of the reports, the stories, the research that she'd done, videos that I had to watch. That's the only way that I'll come. So I agreed to do that, and for 2 solid weeks I sat at my desk pouring over this Canadian content of sadness and sorrow. And it was there where God clearly said, you know who you've been praying for all those years? This is who I want you to show justice and mercy to. And this, I believed, was also something that our churches needed to wake up and get involved in. So God had answered my prayer of Micah 6:8. This was who I was to show justice and mercy to. Little did I know that God, you know, as he always does, he's got our ways planned out for us. I had no idea at the time that Defend Dignity was just being birthed, that something else was happening in the court system. And so this picture that you will see, I'm sure is recognizable to you. That's Terry Jean Bedford, who took Canada's prostitution laws to court, claiming that they were unconstitutional. This was all happening in the lower courts of Ontario as we were being birthed. Very soon into our birthing process, we recognized that this was at play. And eventually, as you know, this is what propelled the whole prostitution legislation. The Parliament had to respond to what was happening in the Supreme Court on this level. But in the process of that, we were birthed. And one of the things that we felt we needed to do was educate our churches, because they just didn't understand and know what the issues of sexual exploitation looked like in our country. So that's where this wonderful partnership with EFC began. As I started researching, I realized that she was researching in Ottawa on the very same things, and sort of the rest is history. This great partnership came into being. So what we did initially, it was purely the outcome we wanted was to see our churches educated, which we were doing through holding 32 different, what we called information forums from coast to coast across the country. Here in Manitoba, we've been in Steinbeck, Morton, Brandon, Winnipeg, Portage, over the last 2.5 years. But soon into these things, we recognized that, hey, we could influence our churches to write letters and to engage with the government on this, and that's exactly what needed to happen. We needed to have people like you knocking on the doors of their MPs saying, first of all, do you understand what's at stake here with sexually exploited people? And here is what you can do. So we put together template letters, we put together MP packets and encouraged our people to go and to visit their MPs. And thankfully, what's so delightful is we did have open doors to visit MPs. These these lovely four don't mind us showing their pictures. And these, along with countless others, we went and visited their offices in Ottawa, and along with our constituents, visiting their local MP offices. We held events on Parliament Hill in conjunction with EFC, and all sorts of open doors to move forward on this issue. We were asked to be one of the witnesses to the Justice and Human Rights Committee as they considered the legislation last July, and I believe that ultimately Defend Dignity helped with the passing of that brand new prostitution legislation, now called the Protection of Communities and Exploited Persons Act. Our work focuses on three main areas. We continue to raise awareness. We still do these information forum events all around the issues of sexual exploitation in the country. Really, we've far crossed denominational boundaries. In case you're wondering, we've gone outside the walls of CNMA, and our denomination is happy that we're doing that. We're trying to mobilize and engage the church to respond with some action steps. And so God has wonderfully connected us with five survivors who not only speak at our events, but they inform and guide us in all of the decisions that we make, in all of the presentations and all the work that we do. And it was through their influence that we believed that we needed to do more than just raise awareness. We needed to provide aid, and aid in the form of certainly some financial services that people can now apply to, a fund that we have in place to respond, so a church or an agency can come to us and say, hey, we're working with a girl who needs some exit service kind of money. She needs first and last month's rent or all those kinds of things. And so we've put that in place. But I wanted to know, because I'm here, I wanted you to know, because I'm here in Manitoba, about another partnership that God has beautifully put together. And that is with this woman. She herself is a trafficking survivor. I don't know if anybody recognizes her. She works for the Manitoba government. She directs Street Reach Manitoba, which is the Manitoba response to sexually exploited children and youth. So she is the head of that whole thing. She's out on the streets working with police and social service workers. Jen was trafficked by a gang herself here in Canada, and so completely understands the issue. She's working on her master's in sociology, and is a delightful partner for us. But one of the great things that Jen has done is put together fantastic training, primarily for child and family service workers and police, but also beyond that, she's happy to have anyone come. So long story short, I met Jen when I took the training myself a few years back, and she now has agreed to come and train all of our youth and children's pastors in this issue. She's agreed to shrink the training down to about a day's training. And so we are in process with developing this training. We're taking it across the country, literally coast to coast in six different locations over the next 2 years. And so I'm so pleased that she will be able to now train. I don't know how many of you are here hoping to be a youth pastor one day, but pastors need training in knowing what are the signs that we can help understand our kids better. What are the signs of being trafficked? What makes a kid vulnerable to prostitution and any kind of sexual exploitation? Then the next thing we do is advocate for law and policy reform. And as we've already said, again, this is a lot where our worlds collide with EFC, and we're so grateful for the success that God brought with that legislation, and we're watching with interest to see what's going to happen now with the new government. Just so you all know, we're trying to stay as on top of that as possible. We collaborate with a number of other agencies, not all faith-based, survivors and all sorts of people right from coast to coast. In fact, we've got a meeting on Thursday with this group to talk about this very thing. What should we be doing now with the new government in place to try and stay on top of where this legislation may end up going? Sadly, parts of Canada are completely ignoring it, having declared that they won't enforce it. And so we're trying to come up with ways to strongly encourage them to enforce it. But here again in Manitoba, because this is where we are today, I thought you would find this very interesting to note, that you guys, this province, does an exemplary job of working and implementing that new legislation. It's very much a part of the current government's here, their mandate to put an end to child, especially child sexual exploitation. And so the former justice minister there, Mr. Andrew Swan, the fellow on my left side of the screen with the glasses, we've met with him in his office a number of times. He partnered with us, and we exchanged notes and ideas about the briefs that we presented to the Justice and Human Rights Committee. And then the current Justice Minister, Mr. Gordon McIntosh, is extremely supportive of all the work that's being done, extremely supportive of that new legislation. So I thought that you would find that interesting. So now on to the subject at hand. The next huge mountain that we are trying to tackle, really it's a mountain range, is pornography. Because for all the reasons that Julia has already so very well explained to you, it is a form of commercial sexual exploitation, and many do call it digital prostitution. Defend Dignity believes that porn is so tightly linked to all forms of commercial sexual exploitation that it is crucial that we have a public health response. We need to be treating it as the public health crisis that it is. And so we are looking for ways to engage and mobilize the church to action, as well as to inform and educate on this issue. So we've thought through an action plan for individuals and for families, and we've determined some direct action campaigns that I'm going to share with you here in a second. But first of all, what should our individual response be to this? Well, I so strongly encourage you to protect yourself from porn's harms. And I know that there's lots of talk about the pros and cons of filtering, but I still think and do encourage you to install accountability software such as you find with Covenant Eyes. There's others out there, but I'm going to talk about Covenant Eyes. So if you don't know what it is, that means that all online activity, including websites visited, videos watched, chat rooms entered, all of that is shared with an accountability partner of your choosing. So accountability goes a long way, right? When we're trying to get over any kind of habit or addiction, and it's no different here, and it's going to help you maintain a porn-free life, for men or for women. My husband has it installed on all his devices, and the software generates a report to his accountability partner that he's accountable to, and his partner's report gets generated back to him on a weekly basis. They have a quick little phone call, especially if anything sketchy shows up, and it costs about $13 a month, and I strongly encourage you to do that. Maybe you're here today and things have gotten so far out of hand that you don't even feel like accountability is going to really cut it for you, then I cannot encourage you enough to go see a sexual addiction counselor. Or there's a great organization, they're all over Canada, but they do have an office in Winnipeg called Journey Canada, it used to be called Living Waters Canada. Journey's an excellent organization, we partner with them on a number of the things that we do. They've been there, done that, they know all about this, and they believe in a real small group accountability kind of focus to what they do. And so another option there, if you're here today and you're finding that you're struggling with this issue. Julie has already mentioned to you the good website, Fight the New Drug. Well, they've gone a step further, and they have actually done a ton of research and put this online program together called Fortify, and you can download that. I think it's for free. I've downloaded it, but I don't think I paid for it. It's a 30-day thing. So, you know, I've got some questions about it, and yet they're telling us that the success rates are extremely high, and it is designed for college-age kids and teenagers. Something else for sure to check out, and if you're finding yourself addicted here today, that might be at least the starting place for you to go, is to download that and put some of the stuff that they suggest there into practice. We're doing increasing amount of research on women in porn. I really appreciated the question that came earlier about that. It is absolutely one of the fastest growing demographics that are getting involved and addicted to pornography, and so we're trying to come up with better responses to that. I work myself with some women whose husbands are addicted, and I can tell you, and the research bears out, that the response for a spouse that has an addicted spouse is often one of PTSD. That's how severe and how strong the psychological reaction is to it. And so, again, if you're here as a pastor or you're training to be a pastor, get yourself educated on this topic, because pastors' offices are getting flooded with this kind of stuff. And sometimes the way that a gal will come in presenting is with depression and anxiety and a lot of other things, but when you dig deep, this is her physiological response to her husband's pornography addiction. There's a great documentary out there, again, if you're here and looking for a resource, called The Heart of the Matter. It's about an hour and a half, interviews moms, dads, every angle of relationship that gets affected by pornography. It's well done and certainly worth your considering. Then if you're here as a dad or a mom, there's a few ideas for your family. Don't, again, as Julie has already so well said, start that conversation early with your kids. I'm a grandma of almost 7 grandchildren, and my oldest grandchild is 8, and I've had many conversations with my son and his wife about the need to have this conversation soon with my grandson. I already know from the things that our grandson is saying to me that it's time that conversation happens. And I'm sorry, I don't want it to be that way, but it is that way. And so no matter how awkward you feel about it, be out there talking with your kids. The average age of exposure, as we've already heard, is 10 to 12, so we need to be in there much earlier and tell them how beautiful that gift of sex is, and it should not be, it cannot be destroyed by pornography. So we need to be proactive. We're doing a whole lot of research on what good resources are out there, and so these ones are fantastic. Good Pictures, Bad Pictures, it's fairly recently published. My daughter-in-law is a school teacher and a mom, and I've had her review all this material to see what she thinks of it. Good Pictures, Bad Pictures is excellent. I would highly recommend it for ages 6 to 10. You can go through it and see if you think your child is ready for it, but it's a very, very good book to help parents in a storybook form talk to their child about this. And then these others that were already referenced on the video that Julia showed from Empower and Educate Kids, 30 Days of Sex Talks, and they're broken into age brackets. And we've got both of these resources available at our table. I didn't bring many, but if first come, first serve, if you're interested in purchasing them, we've got them for sale here today. There's lots of free downloadable items on the Covenant Eyes website for parents as well. All sorts of ideas on how to talk to your kids, how do you have conversations with them. It really is an excellent website, and so I encourage you to take a visit there. Just as having accountability software is good for you as the individual, it's also good for the family, and it maybe doesn't filter everything out, but it will do a really good job about it. You can have a report generated to you as mom and dad if you have that on all of your children's devices. And they also just have a plain old good filter that will filter out a lot of stuff. So it's a great resource. And then I know it's tough. Trust me, I know it's tough. But take the time to understand the apps that are on your kids' devices, because so many of them are gateways to pornography. Again, we've got some good literature that comes out of the Canadian Child Protection Agency that's free, talking about online safety, that does highlight some of these very apps and what they are. And so it's not a bad idea to pick up your kid's device and just check it out and see what's on there and become as media literate as you possibly can. Then Defend Dignity has, because we so believe in this whole issue that we need to be educating and empowering the church to respond, we've put together a half-day conference called Reveal, with the main goal to educate it and to come up with good responses to this whole area of living in this pornified culture. And so what we've got, it's a seminar-based conference. We do a seminar called Parenting in Porn. We have a retired RCMP officer on our team who has spent literally 100 hours of research on this, and the seminar is getting pretty good reviews on how do we have conversations with our kids and what are the things to be aware of. So it's a full hour seminar, so much more in depth than what I've just shared with you today. We also have a seminar that talks about the whole brain side, what's happening in our brains about this, some of the stuff that Julia shared today, and then what are the effects on our relationships. And so that is another of the seminars, and then we'll do something as well along the lines of some of the campaigns that I'm about to tell you about. Julia participates with us in that one as much as possible. The next time we do it is 2 weeks down the road here in Calgary, but we're coming back to this area, to Morton actually, on February 20th, Saturday morning, and we'll be doing the Reveal conference there. Then, as we've also heard, our country needs to address this pornography problem. We do need a Canadian response. And so we are going to be asking the government to put a warning label on all print and internet pornography, just like tobacco's got that warning label because of its health hazard, so should pornography have a warning because it is addictive and therefore harmful. And so it needs to be clearly noted on all internet and print pornography. And then Julie has already talked about the showing of the ID If you're not of age, if you're not 18, you should not be able to access internet porn. And then I want to talk to you in conclusion here about some direct action campaigns that I'm really hoping once they're live and running, you will share, you will get involved in. And what we're hoping is that number one, it's going to go a bit viral. And secondly, we hope that this is going to attract, we're going to be doing some press conferences and that kind of thing. We hope it's going to set the course for these government visits, right? If the government's hearing about this already, some of these direct action campaigns, then we're hoping they're going to open their doors a bit wider for us to come in and meet with them about some of the public health response that we want to create. So the first one is what we're calling our porn-free, family-friendly Wi-Fi campaign. And we are initiating a campaign, we're hoping it's going to go live in the next 3 weeks, to ask Starbucks, McDonald's, Tim Hortons, and Subway to use internet filtering on their public Wi-Fi. We all love the fact that they have public Wi-Fi in their stores, but we are saying you need to put filtering on there so that we're not going to have issues with pornography. And Jennifer Richardson says this: child pornographers and sexual predators want to avoid detection. Public Wi-Fi without filtering that prohibits pornography provides a safe haven for offenders and puts children at risk. So she's the Street Reach Manitoba woman, and she has allowed us to be able to use this quote on the material we're using. So take note of this. The website is not yet live, but it will be here in 2 weeks, we hope. Familyfriendlywifi.ca, I should have had it on that slide, will be an email online petition that you'll be able to sign and then share widely. So we're sending registered letters to the CEOs of these Canadian companies asking them to do that, and then we hope that with every 1,000 signatures we get for petition, we'll be able to send those off so that they can recognize that the public is not happy with that kind of response. The UK, obviously, as we've already shared, Starbucks and McDonald's in the UK do not have pornography in their stores. They have family-friendly Wi-Fi, and so if they can do it in the UK, I think they can do it here. The second campaign that we'll be launching sometime after Christmas, again, will mirror this campaign that already exists in the States, and that is Cosmo Harms Minors. Cosmopolitan magazine over the last 25 years has really morphed into a very pornographic magazine. And so the big deal here is that it's available anywhere, right, in grocery stores, anywhere that sells magazines. It's at eye level. In fact, my husband and I were in Chapters, and I specifically went to the magazine counter, and there it was, right at this level of my nice 8-9-year-old grandchildren. And so that's disturbing to me. I sat and looked through it, and it is indeed pornographic. So what we're saying is, Cosmo, or rather to the retailers, cover it up. Put a brown paper covering on it. Keep it out of the eye of our children. And it really does target young teenage girls. That's the market that they're after. And so we want to say that can happen no more. Again, Walmart in the States has already done that. You cannot go into a Walmart store in the States and get that magazine with the cover as it is. It's got a brown paper covering over it. Then the last campaign, which will be a very major undertaking for us, again, will mirror the campaign in the States that pornharms.com has done. And that is, they have put together a list called, they call it the Dirty Dozen, which I think is fantastic. This is an annual campaign that they run. They've done hours and hours of research on companies and organizations in the States and come up with a list of 12 organizations that promote pornography and therefore promote sexual exploitation. And then an email-driven campaign so that the emails that you write get sent directly to the CEO's desks of these major companies. So, are they being successful? You bet they are. If you've heard over the last year, Hilton Hotels, Marriott Hotels, and now Hyatt Hotels, all their global hotels have pulled pornography out of their hotel rooms. And that is only thanks to this campaign. The other great thing that's happened is American Apparel. I don't know, do you have American Apparel in Manitoba here? Okay, so their commercials, their billboards are pretty raunchy. And they as well made the Dirty Dozen list, and now they have pulled all sexualized advertising from any of their marketing. So it is possible. It is possible to demand these kinds of changes if we all get involved. And what's happened down there, because there's been such a good public response, is that now government, Congress down there, is willing to interact and have conversations on addressing pornography as a public health crisis. And so that's what we're hoping for here as well. One more little campaign to tell you about and then I'm done, and that's not directly related to porn, but I don't know how many of you here are familiar with the Amnesty International decision that was made this summer. Amnesty International, right, we think of as a human rights organization, and we usually think positively about Amnesty International, only they have made an extremely foolish decision in that they are calling for prostitution to be legalized around the world, which goes completely against what we believe and what our Canadian legislation has in place. And so we have put together a postcard campaign. If you take 2 seconds to sign a postcard at my table today before you leave, you can jot a couple lines. We've got a sample there for you to use. And then pop it in the mail. It's already addressed to the Canadian headquarters of Amnesty International to let them know, again, we are unhappy with that decision and we hope to see something changed. Trisha Bapti, the survivor I have mentioned, has written a fantastic piece as to why Amnesty needs to make a change there, and you can pick up copies of that at the table as well. So that's it. Thanks for your hopeful participation in these upcoming campaigns, and thanks for the time.